last lecture, we talked about the experiments that led to the discovery that DNA was indeed the molecule of genes. The DNA did carry the information that genes carry. And upon that, the acceptance of that, of those discoveries, a race was on to discover the structure of the DNA molecule. And as you know, Watson and Crick won that race and solved a structure, came up with a plausible model for the structure of DNA, shown to your right, which is double helical B-form DNA, which is the hydrated form of DNA and is the most prevalent form of DNA in your cells. And with this, we'll talk a lot more about the structure of DNA in detail later, but for now, once the structure of DNA was solved, it was very important to discover the mechanisms by which information was encoded in that DNA. So how was it that information in the molecule of DNA, in genes, could encode, for example, blue flowers, blue morning glory flowers, or red morning glory flowers? How is it that alleles could specify phenotypes? How is the information in DNA decoded? And how did mutations occur? We're looking at two flower types in morning glories, and the red flower is a mutation of an allele. The red allele is a mutation of what was formerly a blue allele. How do those changes occur? And the decade after Watson and Crick made their discovery, from 1953 on, the decade or so afterwards was spent studying the mechanisms by which DNA encoded information and the mechanisms by which that information was decoded. And those central dogma processes, the replication of DNA, the transcription of DNA, and the translation of messenger RNAs, was to occupy molecular biology for its first few decades after Watson and Crick made their seminal discovery in 1953. And so in the next bit, we're going to be looking at the central dogma processes from a historical perspective and look at some of the experiments that led to our initial understanding of these processes. Then we'll move on to some basic biochemistry, and after that we can tackle the molecular mechanisms in detail of those central dogma processes. So that's where we're headed over the next few weeks. You may remember from introductory biology that when Watson and Crick discovered the structure of DNA, what immediately became apparent was that the structure provided a mechanism by which the molecule could be replicated. So in the double helix to the right, the two strands of the helix could serve as templates upon which new strands of DNA could be synthesized. And this became known as the semi-conservative model of DNA replication and was shown to be the case by Meselson and Stahl in some of their famous experiments. And to review that model very briefly, if this is a parental molecule of DNA, shown schematically, and base pairs are in the middle of the molecule, of course. So we're showing this in ladder form. And that replicates, we first separate the two parental strands of DNA, and upon those parental strands, new daughter strands of DNA are synthesized. So we build two new daughter strands of DNA using the base pairing rules of A, T, G, C to ensure that the proper nucleotides are inserted opposite the template strand. So here we have the primer strand of a new molecule. These are both primer strands here. And then we have the template strand here and here. So that we end up with daughter molecule 1 and daughter molecule 2, and these, each one of these daughter molecules are identical to the parental molecule here. So this is the semi-conservative model, and you can review that by consulting some videos on the DM Flyboy site. So you can go to DM Flyboy channel and go to lectures 11.2.1 and 11.2.2. These two lectures on the introductory DM Flyboy channel will be relevant if you need to review the evidence which showed that the semi-conservative model, in fact, was the correct model through the experiments of Meselson and Stahl. Meselson and Stahl published their findings that proved the semi-conservative model for DNA replication in 1958. And 1958 was also a big year because it was in that year that Arthur Kornberg and co-workers at Stanford University purified an enzyme from E. coli, the human gut bacterium, that would conduct DNA synthesis in vitro. So the molecule, the enzyme, was DNA polymerase. And this was the first DNA polymerase purified from any organism. And so they called that DNA polymerase 1. So this is DNA pol 1 or DNA polymerase 1. And again, the laboratory that whose work we're talking about over the next little bit is Arthur Kornberg's laboratory at Stanford. And having purified an enzyme that would synthesize DNA in vitro, it's the mechanism by which DNA is replicated could be investigated quite nicely. So Kornberg and his co-workers used radio-labeled nucleotides to look at the incorporation of those nucleotides into DNA by DNA polymerase 1 into growing nucleotide chains. And they just, in the process of investigating DNA polymerase, they noted several enzymatic activities. And the first, as you probably remember, is a 5' to 3' polymerase activity, for which the enzyme is named. And that is, this adds nucleotides to a growing DNA chain in the 5' to 3' direction. And I'll refresh your memory on that in just a moment. The second enzymatic activity that was found, interestingly enough, was a 3' to 5' exonuclease activity. Here we look at this as DNA synthesis or polymerization. Here we are removing, this activity is the removing of nucleotides from a DNA strand in the 3' to 5' direction. And that's odd because this is the opposite activity to what the polymerization activity is, building DNA in the 5' to 3' direction. And this we will find is a proofreading activity that removes nucleotides when they are mismatched in terms of their Watson-Crick base pairing abilities. So if a C is inserted, let's say, instead of a T in a growing chain, the polymerase backs up, so we're synthesizing along here, 5' to 3'. If a wrong base is inserted, let's say this base, this blue base is the wrong base, the 5' to 3' polymerase activity ceases and a 3' to 5' exonuclease activity removes the wrong nucleotide from the chain. So it chops that off. So that is a proofreading activity of the polymerase itself that removes misincorporated nucleotides. Wrong nucleotides are removed by this activity. And then finally, we have another enzymatic activity that is a 5' to 3' exonuclease activity. And you may remember from introductory biology that this exonuclease activity is involved in removing nucleotides ahead of the polymerase. That is, if you have a DNA chain like this and another DNA chain like this with a gap in them, a polymerase molecule will be synthesizing DNA in the 5' to 3' direction. And if it engages another strand ahead of it, it will remove nucleotides, it will chop them off in the 5 to 3' direction. And we will study this when we talk about the details of DNA replication and Okazaki fragments. But for now, let's visit some experiments, a key experiment anyway, that showed the nature of polymerization activity being a 5' to 3', and not a 3' to 5' synthesis. Polymerases and all known DNA polymerases only synthesize in the 5' to 3' direction. So let's look at that experiment now. So let's imagine a nucleotide chain that is being built. And let's say we already know it's being built in the 5' to 3' direction, and that we already know the mechanism of catalysis, or in terms of what happens when new nucleotides are added to a growing chain. So I'm just drawing a nucleotide chain here with starting at a 5' end, and we have a sugar designated by S. That sugar has a 5' and 3' carbon indicated by 5' and 3', and it is attached to a nitrogenous base. Here's two nucleotides long, and the last nucleotide in the chain has a free 3' hydroxyl group attached to it. And you can go back and review mechanisms of DNA synthesis from introductory biology if you'd like. So now we're adding a new nucleotide to this chain, let's say, and we need to consider that the substrate for catalysis involves both a growing DNA chain, being built off a template, of course, which we're not showing here, and a deoxynucleotide triphosphate, that is a, for example, DATP or DCTP, or GTP or GTTP. So if we consider how that nucleotide is added to a growing chain, that is how DNA catalysis occurs, we have a nucleophilic attack of the last 3' oxygen that's hanging off the 3' carbon on the first phosphate of the incoming nucleotide. That would be the alpha phosphate. And that nucleophilic attack then allows the oxygen to lose a hydrogen and to be joined to the phosphorus, the alpha phosphorus atom of the incoming nucleotide. So that what has happened is that we've added this part of the nucleotide, a nucleotide monophosphate, if you will, to the previous end of the DNA molecule. And now we have on the 3' end a free 3' hydroxyl group. So we have added a nucleotide to the 3' end of the growing chain. And the 5' phosphorus atom, the alpha phosphate, is linked to the 3' oxygen of the previous nucleotide. Now, if that phosphorus atom were labeled with a radioactive label, we could follow its behavior when we digested the DNA and see what atoms it was attached to. And this was the genius of Kornberg and colleagues, is that they conducted DNA synthesis activity in the presence of radioactive cytosine, where the alpha phosphate was labeled with the P32 isotope. And then they subjected that DNA so produced to nuclease digestion. But nucleases that digested at a particular position in the chain, specifically nucleases that would cut the chain at oxygens between the 5' carbon of the last added of any nucleotide and the phosphorus, the 5' phosphorus. So the cut is made at the arrows indicated, with the net result then that nucleotides would be released where the phosphate would now be attached to the 3' oxygen of nucleotides. That is, the phosphorus would be transferred in a way, if this was the mechanism of DNA synthesis, it would be transferred in a way to previous nucleotides in the chain. And so by following this radioactive phosphorus atom, they could see that the phosphorus was now liberated with all four different nucleotides, not just C. And if synthesis had been in the opposite direction, and you might want to do that thought experiment on your own, it would be found that if you were adding radioactive nucleotides at the end of a growing chain, cytosine, let's say, and then you digested with nuclease, you would simply release a phosphorus atom linked only to released cytosine with this particular nuclease treatment. And this and other experiments allowed Kornberg and colleagues to deduce that DNA polymerase activity is exclusively in the 5' to 3' direction. So in the next lecture, we'll actually talk about why polymerases may have evolved to only have 5' to 3' polymerase activity and not the reverse.